as if to somehow protect it from the harshness of the season. Winter blankets the landscape with a thick coat of white. The land is asleep, and only the sound of the brook breaks the overwhelming silence of the woodland. Let us follow the brook along its course as it flows through the countryside and through the seasons. Come along with me, and through the eye of my camera, let me share with you the joy and excitement of being close to this marvelous thing called nature. Icy clear water meanders across the flats and caresses the glacial boulders that now take on a new and wonderful shape under their winter dress. The frost, with artistic imagination, decorates the riverbanks with crystals. And the brook seems to enjoy the special attention as it dances and tumbles on its way. Winter moves along. It's now late February. And along the riverbank, the woods are also the subject of nature's attention. For March brings with it the silver thaw. Now that Mother Nature wears her finest jewelry. Layers of warm and cold air, water and ice, and the trees and bushes sparkle in the glitter of early spring. Like a giant crystal chandelier, the woodland shimmers and dances. But sometimes the very forces that create all this beauty can go just a little too far. The glitter then becomes sleet, and the trees are burdened with hundreds of tons of destructive ice. But the balance of nature is precarious indeed, for just 1 degree change in temperature could mean the difference between beauty or destruction. Stripped branches and broken trees are everywhere, and the saplings bow in submission. But this land is strong, and the trees stubbornly await their friend to relieve them of their icy load. The April sun awakens the land and stirs within it the forces of spring. All along our brook, the melting snow feeds the smaller streams that gush and tumble everywhere. The woodland is filled with that wonderful sound of running water. The sun is high and warm, and as we move downstream, we step into the alder beds to stop for a moment to take a look at the awakening of the woods. Tiny shoots reach for the sun. Spring is everywhere. This slope on the western side of our brook is wooded with spruce and fir, with the occasional birch and juniper, and the combination of these trees makes the smells of a spring forest something special. This little squirrel is not a native to these woods. Squirrels were introduced to the province some years ago, and this little fellow celebrates the ending of winter with a carefree life in the trees. The chipmunk is a later addition to the introduced species to the island, and they are thriving everywhere. I've spent hours watching and filming these friendly little fellows. They have certainly added a new interest to my walks in the woods. The sturdy and persistent alder catches my eye. Also, the new growth on this young birch. Subjects to photograph and study surround me everywhere. I take a deep breath of clean, fresh air and enjoy this display of nature through the viewfinder of my camera. Even the lowly juniper or larch displays flowering beauty at springtime. The magic of nature is everywhere. The wild cherries blossom along the riverbank. The month of May brings with it warm breezes from the southwest, and the woodland blossoms. Spring has set in with determination, and the snow runoff has passed. The brook is settling down to the business at hand, of feeding the many small lakes and ponds as it courses to the sea. Here, Canada geese have arrived to preen themselves in the warm noon sunshine. They will stay and nest in the marshy flats around the edge of the pond. They come here each year to raise their young. This pair, like all geese, have mated for life. And the old gander is very protective over his mate. He seems to be quite upset with my presence, even though I'm over 100 feet away and using a telephoto lens. But his concern is not only with me. A fox lies casually by, waiting for the right moment to make his move. But these mature Canada geese are quite aware of his tricks. He won't be dining on goose today, that's for sure. But those young ones later on in the summer, well, now that's another matter. Down the pond, other waterfowl set up residence. The tall grasses and small islands and lots of feed make these small ponds ideal for nesting sites. But you have to be very cautious trying to get close to ducks. Sometimes it takes hours to get one good photograph. In this nearby tree, a small owl keeps a sharp eye on things. They spend the days in the dark shadows of the woods. But at night, they take over the woodlands and hunt for mice and shrews, and I've even seen them take young rabbits. The calm, mirrored surface of the pond is broken by a visitor. This sleek and graceful swimmer is an otter. He's a curious and playful fellow, and he can entertain you for hours. Now, this little fellow moves on the pond and heads straight for me. He's curious and determined to see what I'm all about. Satisfied that I'm not worth spending any more time with, he heads back for the pond to do whatever it is that otters do. Our little owl shows little interest or appreciation of the otter, or me either, so I move on. Even now, in late May, there are still some patches of snow deep in the forest. And here, a snowy owl suns himself. These Arctic owls arrive in Newfoundland each spring. They follow the Arctic drift ice and probably feed on seal carcasses. When I was a boy growing up on Tulingate Island, these great white owls were numerous. We hunted them for food and ate them. But they're protected now. The DDT has taken a terrible toll of this great white owl. Before we leave the slope of this river valley, let us look down and see the wonders that are everywhere on the floor of the forest. Here, varieties of mosses and lichens create a new and wonderful world in miniature. If we are to really enjoy nature, we must take the time to observe the little things. We are often in a hurry, and sometimes we pass the things that are most interesting. This young rabbit is also the result of his ancestors being brought to this island back at the turn of the century. They flourished, and at one time we had the highest density of rabbit population anywhere in the world. But today, the lynx has kept that under control. Look how well he blends into his surroundings. He's almost invisible. It's impossible to see him. Well, this is the rabbit's main defense. This lynx shows some interest, but he's already eaten today, and I guess it's just not worth the trouble right now. But Mr. Rabbit decides that that was close enough, so he puts as much distance as possible between himself and the big cat. Life continues as usual along the brook. Let us now move a little further back into the woods. Let's go to the ridge that forms this river valley. Here, moose feed on birch, willows, and aspen. But soon, the marsh ponds will provide lily pads and other aquatic plants that will attract these animals down to the open country. This lovely bull's antlers are in velvet. This time of the year, they're growing. But late in the fall, they will be shiny and golden. These animals are all along the ridge and right down to the river. Their sign is everywhere. The moose population is growing, and they may be seen very close to the city. Hunting with a camera has many more rewards than hunting with a rifle. You don't need a license, and you can shoot any kind of animal. And believe me, it's much more difficult to stalk and film an animal than it is to hunt him. And besides, confronting a large bull moose with only a camera has its own special kind of excitement. We will now move upstream along the ridge to the marshes that feed our brook. These central islands are the home of the caribou. It's now almost summer, and this young doe shows off her spring's calf. These woodland caribou move between the cover of the strings of black spruce and the open marshes. This country is ideal for caribou, and the herds are strong and growing. But these marshes have a beauty all their own in their unique plants and flowers. This is our provincial flower, the insect-eating pitcher plant. And here is the succulent bakeapple. But it's the iris that gives a touch of elegance to the marsh. Restless stags and does move along the ridge. While this contented mother and her youngster rest in the sunshine, the main herd spreads out in front of me as far as I can see, while this curious little calf comes up within a few feet. Other animals seek the shelter and seclusion of the woods. Checking his does, this noble stag moves on. She watches them leave. But it's cool here on the high ground, so she stays. This Arctic hare also likes the coolness of the forest. He stands motionless, but he's very much alert. Unlike the moose, the Arctic hare and the caribou are native to the island. Our stag checks a scent along the trail, and he marks it with a gland underneath his eye. Each creature of the forest has its own special ways, and each of them for a purpose. Animals, just like plants or trees, must follow a course that is laid down by time. Everything in the wilds is subjected to the strict discipline of Mother Nature. Now early summer, and our brook is freshened by a late June rain. The sun is high this time of the year, and its strength has tamed the waters of our stream. It's now soft and warm as it tumbles over falls on the last few miles to the sea. Near the ocean, the high shoreline permits the brook to show off its real beauty as it cascades over sheer cliffs into deep, dark pools. Here, children with adventure and daring find spots like this, a real escape the warm summer sun. It's also a challenge, and like children everywhere, a place to show off, a place to show one's nerve and courage. Our brook has certainly provided a magnificent swimming hole. But some people from a nearby village have decided that since nature's provided such a perfect setting, they'd like to help things along, just a little. So they've built changing houses, constructed paths and walkways, and have cribbed up the banks of the brook as well as the hillsides to prevent rock slides and erosion. They've also built a small dam downstream, and they've created this lovely little pond. You can fish here as well as swim. Oh, to be young again, to feel the freedom and excitement of youth. This land is really for the young. But unfortunately, many of our children have not yet discovered this province's wonderful gifts of nature. July brings hot days and black flies to the woodlands, so we leave our brook and take our camera to the coastal areas of the province. Here on the northeast coast, visitors from all over the world come here to Twillingate to enjoy the cool ocean breezes, the magnificent scenery, and to photograph icebergs. These mountains of ice must surely be one of nature's greatest works. They drift into our bays and erode during the summer. They founder and break up slowly. Sometimes they stay until August. Some come to walk the beaches, while others visit by boat. This bay has thousands of lovely islands, and many sailors are now discovering this beautiful Notre Dame Bay. Once they come, they'll be back again, for this area has a certain way of getting into your blood. But I've taken you here to show you the natural beauty of the land. The hills look bleak, but just back from the saltwater spray of the ocean, nature blooms in all its glory. The color and smell of wild clover, the delicate little bluebells that share the sun with the wild sedges and grasses. The daisy or bachelor button dominates the landscape with flashes of white and yellow. Even the thistles and the stinging needles offer the photographer a contrast of shapes and colors. The very much unappreciated weed, the dandelion, is both beautiful and edible. And a variety of wild leaves and plants that just stagger the imagination. They abound everywhere. Flowers, plants, leaves, and grasses combine to perfume the ocean air, giving it a freshness that is quite unique. But what a perfect spot this is for a holiday. Massive granite cliffs, hills just waiting to be climbed and explored. Beaches uncrowded and clean, just waiting to captivate a family. But the beach also offers a variety of plants that stubbornly cling to the rocks just above the high water mark. The wild parsnip is quite common, and of course wild peas are tasty beyond description. But for some of us who love the outdoors, nature is most appreciated sometimes by just being alone. Lost in the wonderful solitude of familiar sights and sounds, that somehow have a special personal meaning. Well, summer is almost over, and there's a coolness in the air. Our brook sparkles in the September sunlight, but the photographer in me starts to yield to my fishing and hunting instincts, for large trout are now moving into the brook. I can't wait to cast a fly. Some of the leaves already show a hint of autumn, and the woodlands will soon burst forth with a blaze of color. The bull moose's antlers are no longer in velvet, and the rutting season is close at hand. This proud old bull displays his restless spirit. This cow will probably stay close to the bull for the next month or so. And next spring there will be a calf. The seasons complete their cycle, and nature unfolds her bounty in a consistent and beautiful order. But man has taken on the role of custodian and manager of Mother Nature's wealth, and he has not always acted wisely. We all have the right to enjoy the forests and streams, but with that right comes an awesome responsibility. We must protect it, and guard it, and above all, appreciate it. But if we want to learn the real meaning of our natural blessings, I can't think of a better thing to do than to stop and smell the flowers. For in doing so, we may avoid stepping on the next one. Or to drink from a cool, clear brook. This too may make us a little more careful of where we throw our garbage. But most of all, let us never pass up an opportunity to walk a woodland trail. There we may experience the joy of spending a moment with some animal of the forest. Now, if we do all these things, the land will become part of our soul, and then we may be confident that we shall never have to worry about the future of this wonderful Newfoundland outdoors.